Do we really have to do that?
We're through the looking glass now, everyone. We're living in a vortex. Everybody's changing sides. Who's the goodies? Who's the baddies? Who's the establishment? And who's the anti-establishment? Remember when we were told that we had to be scared of despots and tyrants and dictators? Well, now it seems that the people that are telling you that they care about you and are going to look after you are the baddies. Because if you weren't the baddies, how would you love Dick Cheney? Surely we could all agree that Dick Cheney started unnecessary wars, that American project deal where they needed an event that was like Pearl Harbor. Remember that? Like, Dick Cheney, by any reckoning, even Liz Cheney doesn't think Dick Cheney is a good guy. Here's a conversation between John Stewart and Tim Walz, where John Stewart, being, I would say, old school conventional John Stewart, challenges Tim Walz on the Democrat Party embracing the endorsement of Cheney. What does that tell you? I'm talking to you if you're considering voting Democrat. You're voting now for that. You're doing what Dick Cheney would do. Would you also go to Iraq and have another war based on all that? Would you set up Halliburton with great deals across the world? Is it not possible that what's happening between Ukraine and Russia and other wars being waged across the world are comparable to that unnecessary and ridiculous war, set of wars, there was a sequel, wasn't there, in the Gulf? Is it not possible that we have to together pass through a threshold of understanding that we never thought we would have to cross? Here's John Stewart talking to Tim Walz over Cheney's endorsement of Harris Walz and how that extraordinary endorsement has been embraced.
One of the real first qualifications of being a vice president is obviously rifle safety. I think...
yes, it is.
You know, I can't think of a vice president in recent memory that used a shotgun irresponsibly. Nothing comes to mind.
That's right.
Now, John Stewart's going in with a lovely joke. We all enjoyed that moment when Dick Cheney shot a person he was out hunting with, and then that person had to apologise for wasting Dick Cheney's bullet. But that was, in microcosm, part of the problem of a hypocritical, almost subterranean, nocturnal beast of Washington, like Dick Cheney. He ain't the kind of person whose endorsement means, oh, people are crossing the line, this is a new unity party. No, it's a uniparty. It's the party of the military-industrial complex. It's the party of Big Pharma. It's the party of authoritarianism and creeping deeper and deeper despotism. Now, look at how John Stewart changes the subject to accepting the endorsement of the Cheney gang, and look at how Tim Walz sort of fumbles his way through.
How is that? The Cheney thing. Do we really have to do that?
See, now, what you see the laughter in the audience. That's a sort of a New York City audience. I think they do comedy. They do that in New York, I figure. They're like, ha-ha, yeah, well, as long as anything but Trump, like, how far can you go with that anything but Trump mentality? Like, that, for me, feels more like the type of mental approach that does lead to tyranny and dictatorship. Because you're sort of incrementally, like, you know, like, if you actually look at what happened in Germany around the rise of the Nazis, the burning of the Reichstag, the kind of deals that were done with the Kaiser and the Chancellor, and all, not the Kaiser, actually, the Chancellor. Like, it was a slow, incremental process of, oh, we just have to do what's necessary. These bloody communists, we just want to stop all the violence. You know, and in the end, what you wound up with was genuine tyranny. And I suppose whatever side of this argument you're on, primarily the concern is the other party is so bad that it justifies anything, right? People like, you know, a lot of people that are pro-Trump and pro-Republican are like, there's going to be such a clampdown on free speech. There's going to be such a centralization of control. There's going to be a never-ending sequence of crises that are used to legitimize deeper and deeper authority. That's what the Republican... Now, the other side, the Kamala Harris side, are like, you know, I watch it sometimes. I watch like sort of Ben Stiller or sort of people that I've known and like admire saying you just cannot allow a Trump presidency. Well, why at this point?
It goes broader than that. Look, Bernie Sanders, Dick Cheney, Taylor Swift.
No.
Having the Cheneys on board?
Nah. You can't Dick Cheney or Taylor Swift. Nah.
It's a big tent full of war criminals. And also, like, even the Taylor Swift point, I say this as a man with a six-year-old and a seven-year-old daughter, so I have to be, to a degree, sympathetic to Taylor Swift because domestic harmony in my household depends upon it. But Taylor Swift is precisely the kind of endorsement that amounts to a tacit contract with ongoing commerce, consumerism, globalism, broad and widespread inanity, and whatever claims are made about like Taylor Swift as an artist, I'm not in a position to sort of counter those. What you and I know at depth is these are the kind of celebrities that are deployed in order to facilitate further homogeneity and further inanity. It doesn't seem real anymore, does it?
What country did Taylor Swift get us to invade? No!
Well, I mean, she took over England for a little while, I can tell you that, when she was over here. So, okay, so here Kamala Harris and Liz Cheney invoke World War II and Pearl Harbor in order to justify further war. Them tugging on them heartstrings.
Bringing the Allies together is because they are fully aware of, and remember, to the Congresswoman's point, World War II. Remember, this concept of isolation, we were once there as a nation. And then Pearl Harbor happened. Let's remember recent history. Europe remembers it well. We then, when we got attacked, Pearl Harbor, we jumped in. And it is because America jumped in that we were ultimately able to win that war.
I don't know, man, with Kamala Harris. When she's talking, you know when like an unlikely celebrity appears on Sesame Street and it's just jarring to see them talking to Elmo? I feel that all the time when I see her talking. It's like someone trying to inhabit the role of a human being.
And it should be a constant reminder to us. We have to remember history.
I suppose so, don't you? You have to remember it, otherwise it's not there. Oh no! The October the 15th deadline has just passed. Are you prepared for what's coming? It could be crazy. Do you owe back taxes? Are your tax returns still unfiled? Well, if that's the case and you've missed the deadline to file for an extension, you have to ensure that you are ready in the case that the IRS ramp up enforcement. But there's still hope. There is always hope. Tax Network USA has helped taxpayers save over $1 billion in tax debt and has filed over 10,000 tax returns. They specialize in helping people like you reduce their tax burdens. Act now. Visit tnusa.com/brand or you can call 1-800-958-1000. Obviously, it's only applicable if you're a US citizen or at least in the US. You can get free consultation. The experts will walk you through the simple questions that are required to see how much you can save. So take control today. Visit tnusa.com/brand or call 1-800-958-1000. Do it while you still can.
That isolationism, which is exactly what Donald Trump is pushing.
It's not isolationism, it's nationalism. And nationalism is a response to globalism. And people in France, you better believe you me, are having the same feelings. And people in the UK are having the same feelings. And people in India are having the same feelings because everyone's starting to recognize, wait a minute, there are all these sort of global powers that we didn't vote for and that we can't oppose that are usurping our national sovereignty, whether it's bureaucratic entities like NATO or the WHO or WEF or sort of apparent non-government organizations, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, they dropped out Melinda. You can research why yourself. The Clinton Foundation, or more obviously and boldly, massive global titans like Google Alphabet and like Apple. The amount of power wielded by these unprecedented entities like big tech is usurping your ability to run not only your individual life or your family life or your community life, but your whole nation. Nationalism does not equate to racism. Nationalism equates to anti-globalism. Globalism requires consumerism and constant ongoing commodification of all human relationships and every aspect of life. That is why a spiritual argument is one that they flap about and fear most. When people start saying, well, I don't believe we're alive for that long anyway, and I'm connected to a higher power and I'm willing to sacrifice my life for what I believe in, like you are as well. I'm talking about things like, you know, my children, my family, my God. When people start talking like that, rather than, hey, you know, if we spend our life pursuing neater and faster and swifter devices and sort of tighter leggings and more shiny and shimmering baubles acquired at the mall. Like when they've got us on that track, materialist, it's easy for it to sort of lapse into a kind of easy Luciferianism. That's just what I think. Why don't you let me know what you think in the comments and the chat about that? Let's see how this wraps out. One party under God, one party under Satan once the Cheneys are involved.
Pull out of NATO, abandon our friends.
Our friends, like, it's not like Ukraine are, like, I know Ukrainian people and I love all of the people of the earth, you know, as best as I can within the limits I experience as a human being. But you can't imagine that the United States, do you believe this, are running like, that's Ukraine, they're our friends. That's why we've got those CIA bases there and have had them there to protect them. They're our friends. That's why we're hollowing out their nation, allowing hundreds and thousands of Ukrainian citizens to die in an unwinnable war against another superpower that potentially, if America put America first, you'd have to kind of conclude was, at one end of the scale, none of your business. Certainly not worth spending billions and billions and billions of tax dollars on an unwinnable war when there are crises all across America, whether it's the border or the lack of infrastructure or the lack of education or people starving or unable to afford gas. In a democracy, you let people choose whether they want to do their friends first or their family first or foreign friends or whether charity begins at home or not. In a discourse about government, all those questions are up for grabs. And they're trying to bypass your ability to think about stuff like that by going, we're friends with Ukraine. Okay, well, what other countries could we be friends with that are under attack from a neighbouring power that is better armed? Lots of questions if there's a principle at play, but if there is no principle at play, simply utility and the pursuit of a goal, then these things get kind of complicated, don't they?
Isolationism is not insulation.
Remember that. Yeah, because they're different words. Isolation means alone, and insulation, that's something you do in your attic.
It is not insulation. It will not insulate us.
Remember that? Attic.
From harm in terms of our national security. So I say that to emphasize a point that the Congresswoman made. And the other point I'd make is also check out where he's been on how he thinks about America's military.
Who's this persuading? Who's watching this and going, right, I'm not sure who to vote for. This is good. This is good because isolation isn't insulation. Yep. All right. It's good. I'm under control. Like, what if you watch that and think anything other than, oh no, what a desperate predicament. Clearly, the world is being run by hollowed out ciphers, suggesting that there is an ulterior force at work puppeting these vapid individuals. And in fact, I don't even be cruel. I bet Kamala Harris, if you know her, is really nice. I bet even Liz Cheney, if you know her, is really nice. I'm struggling with Dick Cheney, but surely. God is gracious and God is good. But don't you think that possibly when we continually take recourse to spiritual warfare, this spiritual warfare, in the same way that the Lord has no hands but ours, maybe Satan also, or whatever force of evil, and surely evil is real, requires agents here on earth. And I think we're watching them now.
And service members. One of the great, great American heroes, a prisoner of war, John McCain. Remember how he...
Remember that? He made them jokes about his arms. It was not nice. It was not nice that he did that. Yeah, you know, Donald Trump is can be a pretty crass and vulgar individual, but I think what we're talking about is Armageddon and whether or not America is going to lapse into the kind of bureaucratic authoritarianism that Franz Kafka would have balked at. Okay, here's Glenn Greenwald on the subject, our fellow Rumble content creator. Liz and Dick Cheney endorsed Kamala. Embarrassed liberals said the only reason was the Cheneys believe in election integrity, though they think Cheney stole the 2000 election. Was that all them hanging chads down here in Florida? Cheney kept saying, no, it's because we agree with her foreign policy. The foreign policy is war. Endless war, a kind of bellicose, non-defensive Churchill. So there you go. These are strange days indeed. We are experiencing alliances that I think allow us to witness for the first time the silhouette of true power. When you see Kamala Harris there, like as if she's taking having a guest spot on Sesame Street, cozying up to Liz Cheney with the endorsement of Dick Cheney being gleefully embraced with sort of Tim Waltz there, that sort of beaming gurning man who looks like he would be at more ease in one of those contests where you have to eat as many hot dogs as possible at a country fair. Seems that that should be the height of his power, sort of runner-up in a hot dog eating contest. When you see these beaming imbeciles ascending to positions of power, and I say this with all love for them as sort of brothers and sisters on the earth, you have to recognise something dark's going on right now, and we have to respond accordingly with integrity, authenticity, and a deep wakefulness. But that's just what I think. Why don't you let me know what you think in the comments and chat. Remember, if you're watching us on YouTube, turn on the notification bell. It's the only way you'll ever know we make this content, because they are part of the machinery of evil that I've been alluding to throughout this process.
Hey, thanks for watching. If you want to see more uncensored content where free speech can flourish, join our live stream. Click the link right here to watch the next video if you want to, or become a member of a growing movement. Download the Rumble app and you'll be informed every time we make a new piece of content. Stay free.